Good morning, I'm Nawal and welcome to Mamas and Papas. Today we look at the reality of living with albinism and take a closer look at the sensitive issues of surrogacy, adoption and guardianship. We get your children into their soccer boots and tutus. And finally we spend a bit of time with some of the high profile working moms. Is it possible for two black parents to have a white baby? Is it true that albinism is contagious? Hi, Joey, and good morning.
Good morning to you, Noah.
Yes. What do you know about albinism?
Absolutely nothing.
Oh, my word.
Absolutely.
The myth story about them?
I saw it on TV once in a documentary that they used the body parts in Malawi to create some sort of power to other people. That's stupid, honestly. But, yeah. I think people living with a condition of albinism is seen as peculiar. If you don't have enough information about them, your reaction towards them is going to become peculiar, and therefore you're going to think that cutting off somebody's finger living with albinism is going to cure some disease, which is absolutely correct.
Joey, I think me and you need to learn a bit.
Yes.
You know, let's watch this.
Albinism is a genetic condition, so it's inherited through the family, and it's what we call an autosomal recessive condition. And what this means basically is that you have to have two parents who are carriers of this condition, so they themselves do not necessarily have albinism, so they have the normal black skin, but they are then at risk because they are carriers. They are then at a 25% chance with every pregnancy of having a child who is born with albinism.
This issue about being genetic, I'm not quite sure about it, because in my family, as I asked my parents, there is no one who was born like that before us, our grandparents, and I've never heard about it. It was like first time with us, so about it being genetic, I'm not quite sure, but all what I know is from my family, I've got a brother, Geneva, and a sister, Abigail. So from my father is black, my mother is black. I don't have anyone from our elders who is like that.
There are definitely stigmas still attached to albinism in South Africa, and there are lots of stories, depending on who you speak to, and what they have been taught as they've been growing up. So some of the stories that I've heard have been that you get albinism from, or you have a child with albinism from sitting next to somebody with albinism on the bus or on the taxi. One man that I spoke to told me that he, whenever he saw somebody with albinism, he had to spit on his chest. And I asked him, why did you have to do that? And he says he doesn't know, that's just how he was brought up and what he was told to do. There are also stories about albinism where people with albinism don't ever die, they just disappear. And there are people that will swear to you that they've never been to a funeral of a person with albinism.
They depend, because some other children, they come from families we have never seen albino children, and some of their parents, they tell them a lot of stories that maybe if you play with albino children, you might end up having those children. So they depend on the background that they come from. But most of the children, as they start playing with you, they start to realize that there is nothing like that.
So what happens in albinism is that there is a gene which is on chromosome number 15 that has a fault in it. And what this gene does, it causes the normal pigmentation that is in a skin is called melanin. So what happens when this gene is faulty is that melanin is not put down in the skin cells or in the eye cells, different places in the body.
Yeah, if you spend time in the sun, this sun can damage you really badly because you feel severe pain on your skin if you are burnt by the sun, and a day after you start developing some like blisters on the skin. So you really have to stay away from the sun because it might really damage you, because you see some with black spots on the face and all over. That is the result of playing in the sun.
There is no cure for albinism. It's a genetic condition. So if we think about our genetic material, we have genetic material in every single cell in our body. And so there is no cure. You cannot take away the faulty gene that has caused albinism.
We look forward to your questions and comments. SMS mamas for moms and papas for dads to 33126. Today we talk about sensitive topics of surrogacy, adoption and guardianship. We'd like to welcome our guests in studio.
Yeah, welcome guys. Yeah, we have Alex the lawyer, and we have a partnership here going on. It's Carlos and Grant.
Yeah.
A good partnership, because you guys recently adopted a child.
That's correct, yeah.
Yeah, you want to share that story for us?
We met him when he was 14 months and he's been with us. He turns 3 next week.
Wow.
Yeah, it's been with us some time now.
It's excellent.
And what made you guys to adopt? I would love to hear more about
that. Martin and I.
Yeah.
Well, I've always loved children, and I've always wanted to have children. Obviously, being a same-sex relationship, I think it's very difficult to have children. Mm. If I find out the secret that made a man pregnant, I'll let you know. Grant, when I met Grant, you know, from the beginning I've said we need to have children, and Grant felt the same way. So that's where we took it from there. But I think, you know, it's, you know, any parent that is a parent knows that a child changes your lifestyle, changes your life. So
totally.
We didn't take it lightly. That's why it took us a long time for us to actually take the plunge and go find ourselves a little boy.
I just want to ask this, right? So the child that gets adopted, does the parents know where the child is going to go to?
The natural parents of the... Yeah. Well, it depends. In certain situations, you do require that parent's consent if they're still in the picture. If that child has been orphaned, the natural parents of the child are deceased. Alternately, the natural parents of the child abused it or mistreated it.
Uh-huh.
In situations of that nature, their consent is not required. They are not part of the process. There's also an adoptions register.
Uh-huh.
And in terms of that adoptions register, the adoptive parents as well as the child which is adopted is not entitled to that information regarding their natural parents until they're 18 or until that child has reached 18 in respect of the adoptive parents. The only manner in which they can obtain information about the natural parents is for medical purposes only.
Okay, so I want to ask Grant this. Does your child that you guys adopted, does his natural parents know where he is right now?
No, he doesn't.
Okay.
His adoption was a little bit different to the normal adoption, but no, we know about his parents, we know about their background, their past, but they know nothing about us. So.
Okay, that's good.
The social worker that we had, she was wonderful because, I mean, a lot of the parents that she's found children for, they had to do like a little picture book for the parents, because, you know, a lot of mothers give up their children because they have no choice in the matter. So the mothers have contact with the adoptive parents.
Yes.
Even though they have no legal rights, they still know. And, you know, every year they send pictures, you know, and the mother can see them growing up. And then at 18, like Alexandra said, that, you know, the child will have a choice.
Mm.
But in our case, Tiamo won't know his parents until, well, they don't know where he is.
Okay.
And when he's 18, if he wants to find out, we've done it. Well, that's the rules we've set. We'll let him know.
You just said, especially children, South African children that are adopted by overseas families, it is specifically provided for in terms of the legislation that they are to advise that child of their heritage and their cultural background, especially if you've got white Europeans, as an example, adopting a black South African child.
Yes.
They are honor-bound and duty-bound in terms of the Act to advise that child of their cultural background.
Yeah.
Firstly, I'd like to say that, so can Angelina Jolie and that other lady, Madonna, come to South Africa and adopt?
Correct.
They, so she can.
As long as they go through the correct legal channels and they comply with the social workers, etc. Yes.
Okay. Here I am, I'm a surrogate mother, and I decide, I've changed my mind.
I want to keep the
baby. I want to keep the baby. What is the paper trail there before that process?
The situation has actually presently changed very recently, as of the 1st of April. Presently, the process that one has to go through from a legal perspective is one has to conclude at what is known as a surrogacy agreement. That actually has to be made an order of the High Court of South Africa. Mm. Only once it's been confirmed by the High Court can the parties, being the commissioning parent and the surrogate mother, undertake the artificial fertilization process. Also, the court order is only valid for a period of 18 months, which is the approximate period that it would take for the surrogate mother and the artificial fertilization to take.
Yes.
Okay. Thereafter, in the case of where the commissioning parents actually donate the fertilized egg and sperm to the surrogate mother, she can't refuse to hand over that child. However, if they use the surrogate mother's ovum and the commissioning parent's sperm, then she has a period of 60 days to withdraw her consent and essentially cancel the surrogacy agreement.
Thank you to our guests. For further information, please join our online discussion forum on www.mamasandpapasmag.co.za. I'm going to be honest here. I hate the